Welcome, my friends. In this video, we will discuss how to apply the central limit theorem to answer probability questions using a TI-84 calculator. Make sure to check out my video on the central limit theorem first if you haven't watched it already. Also, I only intend students to either watch this video or the video about calculating central limit theorem related probabilities with a table. So if you watch both videos, there will be some repeated information. As a reminder, the central limit theorem states that for any probability distribution, the sampling distribution of the sample mean, x bar, will have a distribution that approaches the normal distribution as the sample size n increases. X bar will have an approximately normal distribution with the same mean as the original distribution and a standard deviation equal to the original standard deviation sigma divided by the square root of the sample size n. If the original distribution looks like this, or any other non-normal distribution, then the distribution of the sample mean will look like this, a normal distribution, assuming that the sample size is at least 30. Suppose the weight of adult males in a population is known to follow a normal distribution, with a mean of 200 pounds and a standard deviation of 25 pounds. If we let x equal the weight of an adult male in pounds, then x is normally distributed with a mean of 200 and a standard deviation of 25. Let's say a sample of 16 adult males is taken. What is the distribution of the sample mean weight of 16 randomly selected adult males from this population? Well, if we let x bar represent the mean weight from a sample of 16 adult males, and we remember that the mean of the sampling distribution is the same as the mean of the initial distribution, and the standard deviation of the sampling distribution is the standard deviation of the initial distribution divided by the square root of n, we know that x bar is normally distributed with a mean of 200 and a standard deviation of not 25, but 25 divided by the square root of n, which is the square root of 16, simplifying to 6.25. I often put a subscript x bar on the standard deviation of the x bar distribution, just to make it really clear which standard deviation I'm referring to. It's a bit redundant in this context, as it clearly applies to x bar, so it isn't strictly necessary, but it isn't a bad idea to include it anyways. I often don't put the subscript x bar on the mean mu, as it is the same regardless if we are referring to the initial distribution or to the sampling distribution. Now hold on a minute, Luke, you might say. Doesn't the sample size need to be at least 30 to say anything about the sampling distribution? Our sample size was only 16. Great question. As the distribution of x is normal, the distribution of x bar will also be normal, even for sample sizes less than 30. Now let's answer a few questions. What is the probability that a randomly selected adult male from this population weighs less than 180 pounds? Since we are asked about a single observation, we turn to the distribution of x and not x bar. The probability statement is the probability x is less than 180. On the graph, we need to find the area on the curve less than 180, which I've shaded in red. Technically, we can go right to the calculator now, but most instructors convert into z-scores first. To do this, we convert x equals 180 into a z-score using the z-score formula, x minus mu divided by sigma. This becomes 180 minus 200 divided by 25, which is equal to negative 0.8. Our new probability statement becomes the probability z is less than negative 0.8. X bar has been transformed into a z-score on the standard normal distribution. If we find the probability of z less than negative 0.8, it will be the same as the probability x is less than 180. We can also add a second horizontal axis to the graph to put the z-scores. Remember that the mean has a z-score of 0, since it is 0 standard deviations from the mean. Let's look to the calculator to find the probability. I'm using a TI-84 calculator here. I already have a video where I went into detail on how to use the calculator to find normal probabilities, so feel free to watch that video if you need to see more examples. For the purposes of this video, I will always be using the z-score to calculate the normal probability. Press second, then distribution, which is under the vars key, and then select the normal CDF function, which is option number 2. The lower bound of our shaded area is infinity, There is no lower bound, but if we put in negative 10, which represents 10 standard deviations below the mean, that will be enough. The upper bound is negative 0.8, which is the cutoff between the shaded red area and the white area. Since I'm entering z-scores, I leave mu and sigma equal to 0 and 1. Scroll down and paste, and you will see the screen as it appears on a TI-83 calculator. If you have a TI-83 or an older calculator, type in the numbers as you see them here. Lower bound, comma, upper bound, comma, 0, comma, 1. Press enter, and we get 0.2119, which is the shaded area on our graph. There is about a 21.19% chance that a randomly selected adult male weighs less than 180 pounds. What is the probability that the mean weight from a random sample of 16 males is less than 180 pounds? This is the probability that X bar is less than 180. The graph looks the same as it did in the single observation case, except now the horizontal axis is X bar instead of X. Do you think this probability is larger or smaller than the probability that we found based on a single observation? Let's find out. First, let's convert x bar equals 180 into a z-score. The z-score calculation is essentially the same as it was in the single observation case, except now we have x bar instead of x in the numerator, and the denominator has the standard deviation of x bar, which we know to be 6.25. We have 180 minus 200 divided by 6.25, which is equal to negative 3.2. The probability statement becomes the probability z is less than negative 3.2. We can also add a second horizontal axis to the graph to put the z-scores. Let's find the area in the calculator. Again, we go to Second, Distribution, Option 2 for Normal CDF. The lower bound is negative 10 again, but the upper bound is the z-score of negative 3.2. The mean is 0 and the standard deviation is 1 for z-scores. Press paste and then enter, and then you will get this scientific notation, saying about 6.87 times 10 to the negative 4th power. This means shift the decimal 4 places to the left, so this number is actually 0.000687, or about 0.0007, rounded to 4 decimal places. Note that this distribution is not drawn to scale. The shaded area should be very tiny. There is about a 0.07% chance that a sample of 16 adult males has a mean under 180 from this population. Wow, that's quite a bit smaller than the probability of 21.19% when we only considered one adult male. The reason the probabilities are so different is because averaging inherently reduces the spread of the distribution. That's why the standard deviation of X bar is so much smaller than the standard deviation of X. It's fairly likely to sample one individual and find values far away from the population mean, but if you are sampling several individuals and averaging the observations, large deviations from the population mean become much rarer. Let's look at another example. Suppose the number of steps Walter takes in a day follows an unknown distribution with a mean of 3,500 and a standard deviation of 900. What is the probability that Walter walks between 3,700 and 4,000 steps on average in 36 randomly selected days? If we let X represent the number of steps Walter walks in a day, then X follows an unknown distribution with a mean of 3,500 and a standard deviation of 900. Since N is 36, which is greater than or equal to 30, we can use the central limit theorem. If we let x bar represent the mean number of steps Walter takes from a random sample of 36 days, x bar follows a normal distribution by the central limit theorem, with a mean of 3,500 and a standard deviation of 900 divided by the square root of 36, which simplifies to 150. We want the probability that Walter walks between 3,700 and 4,000 steps on average from a sample of 36 days. The original distribution is unknown, but that is irrelevant for this problem, as we are dealing with the sampling distribution of x bar. The sampling distribution of x bar is normal, and the desired area is shaded in green between 3,700 and 4,000. The probability statement is the probability 3,700 is less than x bar is less than 4,000. To answer this question, we need to convert 3,700 and 4,000 into z-scores using the formula. The z-score for 3,700 is about 1.33, and the z-score for 4,000 is about 3.33. The new probability statement in terms of z-scores is the probability 1.33 is less than z is less than 3.33, which is equivalent to our other probability statement. We can add our secondary axis to include the z-scores on our graph. In the calculator, you would go to normal CDF and enter 1.33 as the lower bound and 3.33 as the upper bound. You actually don't need to enter 0 and 1 as the last two arguments. They are assumed if you leave them blank. The result is 0.0913, which is the shaded area on the graph. Again, the distribution is not drawn to scale. It is simply there as a guide to help visualize the probabilities. There is a 9.13% chance Walter walks between 3,700 and 4,000 steps on average on any random 36 days. How about this question? What is the 30th percentile of average steps that Walter takes from a sample of 36 days? Well, let's start with a picture. We want some value for steps such that 30% of sample means fall below that value. A percentile always tells you the percentage of observations below that value. The area to the left is all that is needed to use the calculator to find the missing x bar. In the calculator, since we already have a probability and are trying to find a value for x bar, we use inverse norm instead of normal CDF. Inverse norm calculates z-scores, which we can use to convert into a value for x bar. To get to inverse norm, press second, distribution, and then this time select option 3, inverse norm. The area is the area to the left, which is 30%, or 0.3. Leave the mean and the standard deviation the same, at 0 and 1. On other TI-84 versions with this menu, make sure the tail is set to left. Scroll down and then press paste. With older calculators that don't get this menu from earlier, make sure that you match this output. Inverse norm, 0.3. The 0 and the 1 at the end are optional, as they are assumed if you omit them. Press enter, and we get the z-score of negative 0.52. Now that we have the z-score of negative 0.52 from inverse norm, we can include the second horizontal axis on the graph for z-scores. Now we need to convert this z-score into a value for x-bar, so that the units are in steps rather than standard deviations. Recall the formula to find a raw score, which is x equals z times sigma plus mu. If we want to solve for x bar instead of x, this formula is the same except for we use the standard deviation of x bar instead of the standard deviation of the initial distribution. So we have x bar equals negative 0.52 times 150 plus 3,500, which equals 3,422. We can include this value on the graph as well. The 30th percentile for an average of 36 days of steps for Walter is 3,422, meaning that on any sample of size 36, the average number of steps Walter will take will be below 3,422 30% of the time. Alright, that wraps up our examples using the central limit theorem to solve for probabilities using the TI-84 calculator. We'll be exploring many more fun and exciting statistical topics that you won't want to miss, so make sure to check out our other videos.